a friend who walks with me.
Leads me safely through the sinking sand. It is the Christ of Calvary. This would be my burden for each day to help me do the best I can. For I need thy light to guide me day and night. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
Bibles, let's turn over to Luke in chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, I'm going to be in verse 49. Brother Jerry back there, Brother Jerry Hall, Jerry raise your hand. Jerry told me that he got a new Bible. He said he got a brand new Bible. It's got bigger letters in it. Big letters. He said, Joey, I can keep up with you now, so I'm going to be checking you. Make sure you're still reading out that King James Version. I don't do this a whole lot anymore. How many of you got your Bibles? You got a Bible in here with you? Listen, I have it on the iPad. I've read the Bible on the iPad, but I'm going to tell you something. There's nothing better than this book. There's nothing better than this book. I want you reading it. I love Luke. Luke's got some interesting aspects in the Bible, and he does. And if you study the book of Luke and you go through the book of Luke and you read his words and his writings, you will find things. And like I said, a couple weeks back or a month or so ago, I preached on the two guys on the cross. And that conversation that's on the cross is found in the book of Luke. And it's weirdly odd to me because it should have been found in the book of John because John was there. And it's odd to me sometimes. And then you find in the book of Luke one of the greatest stories that's ever written, the story of the prodigal son. It's just amazing some of the things that Luke writes about. And Luke takes time to write this story. And it is a story that is in the life of Jesus Christ. And it is from the time of his birth, and there's a lot of things that are going to happen from the time you're born to the time you're 30, Sammy. There are a lot of things that are going to happen. But oddly enough, in the life of Jesus, this is the only recorded story in the entire Bible. It is. It's when he was 12 years old. Kind of weird. And it's odd to me that, once again, that Luke is the one writing and telling the story. And a lot of people, when we read this story, may not see some of the aspects about it. But I want to talk about to you today about this story when Jesus was 12. And I think it's an interesting story. So if you got your Bibles, Luke chapter 2 and verse 49. And I'm going to read one verse. And he said unto them, how is it that you sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my Father's business? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, this morning, dear God, Jesus, Lord, we're so grateful, we're so thankful for all the many wonderful things. Thankful for the time that we have to come into your house once again. Lord, we're thankful for the season that we're heading into. And God, we're just greatly appreciative of you allowing this church to be part of that and helping in this community. God, I pray this morning to Jesus, Lord, while we're here, that you'd open up our hearts, souls, and mind to give us an understanding of the things that you'd have us to see. Lord, just be with us now, Lord. Show us the things that you'd have us to know. And dear God, Lord, if there's one here today that's never accepted you as their Savior, I pray today would be their day of salvation. First, in your sweet and holy name we pray, Lord. Amen and amen. Amen. Now, sometimes we wonder what kind of parents that we are. And I think a lot of us question what kind of parents we are. Look at Kobe. I'm dead on you, Kobe. You and Sarah got you a young child there that you're getting ready to raise. And there's going to be a lot that's going to happen with that, you know, as she grows up. And there's a huge responsibility that's on you. Max and Allison are getting ready to start that journey and kind of go down that path. And a lot of us have went down that path. I've got to raise three children. And what I mean by that I'm kind of done. You understand what I'm saying? I'm kind of like, they're grown-ups. It's time for them to go do their thing. You understand what I'm saying? Me and Lynn have put into them what we hoped we could. We still throw some advice out, but they're adults, and they're kind of going down a path. But raising kids can be kind of difficult. And I've experienced some things, and I know all of you have, raising kids. And probably one of the toughest things that I ever had in life is when I lost one of my kids. Now, I'm going to ask a question of the parents that are here today that'll be honest. In raising your kid, is there anybody else that while they were raising their kid and playing with them, or they were in the space with us, that they got lost at some point in time, or you misplaced them? Is that a better way to say that? Or maybe you didn't know where they were at. Is there anybody else that ever had that happen? Is anybody? I just want to know if there's anybody that misplaced their kid along the way. Is that a right way to say that? I misplaced my kid? You didn't raise your hand. Wanda raised her hand, but Sammy did not. So we know that Wanda was responsible for Isaac. He wasn't there. It wouldn't have mattered. I can't imagine Mary, and over the next couple of weeks, we're going to have an opportunity, we're going to talk about when God gave us this great gift. But I can't imagine the jubilation that Mary had that when God gave her, Marchie, this ultimate responsibility. I'm not talking about you're going to have a child, but you're going to have the Son of God. Y'all here with me? I'm not talking about, I apologize, and I'm not, I know I know a lot of you think your kids are pretty awesome, but I'm talking about Jesus right now. I'm talking about for just a second, I'm talking about the ultimate responsibility of having the ultimate child, okay? And that's the responsibility that Mary and Joseph got put into their hands. They got the Son of God, and they had to go raise that child. They had to go raise that child. And I'm the weird guy in the room, and I get it. That's the stuff I want to know when I get to heaven. Because I have teenage sons. I've had teenage daughters, and I've watched my kids. Everybody wants to know about the stories and the miracles that happen. When there's time in heaven one day, Timmy, I want to know stories from 0 to 30. I want to know what was going on. I really do. I want to know what was going on in the life of Jesus. I'm not critical of it. I'm just wanting to know, was he doing small miracles and doing things that went unnoticed? I don't know. It's not recorded. And I'm not saying that he did or didn't. I don't know. I know that he was helping Joseph as a carpenter. And I know that they were raising him in that village. But on this occasion, they had went, and the Bible tells us they traveled and went down to Jerusalem for a purpose, and they were all there. But the Bible tells us that they pack up, and they're leaving to go home. And they're leaving to go home. And they lose him. Now, I get that there are a couple parents in this room that there is a kid or two that you had that you would like to lose. Will anybody raise their hand? And do we want to call names on that? It's like we take them places and they still keep coming back. There's a couple of us that have had kids that maybe we would, Toby at times, like, can we just misplace them? But me and Lynn, we've done it. I have two occasions that I had, and one of them was when we were shopping. Same thing. We lost Maggie in a store one day, and ultimate panic. And I thought to myself as we were in ultimate panic, and my story's a little different than Jesus, because after Maggie was with them for a day or two, they would have brought her back. I have no questions about that. They would have been looking us up. They would have found us, and they'd have brought her back, Wanda. That's the truth. And then there was a time, and I know y'all gonna find this hard to believe, but we lost Max. But that story was even funnier because he went to sleep in a box in our house or something downstairs. How old was he, Lynn? How old was he? You remember? Like six or seven. I mean, he was younger. But I mean, we didn't look for him for like 10. I mean, we looked for him for, we were in panic mode, you know. And he was only gone for dull an hour. You understand what I'm saying? And me and Lynn were in panic. I'm out in the yard, in the backyard, looking, going everywhere, trying to find him. Where is he at? And it took us by, and he woke up and, I'm right here. What's wrong with y'all? Everything. I think we beat him for that. Has anybody else ever whipped their kid for probably something they didn't deserve? Jimmy's trying to think. But here Jesus is, Mary and Joseph, and they lost him. And the best part of this, if you read the story, is they didn't figure out that they had lost him until they were a day out. So it took them a day to go back. That's 2 days. And then once they got back there, it took them another day to find him. 3 days. Listen to this. Just so y'all can know that Jesus actually can empathize with us. There was a point in Jesus' life where he was lost. That's true. That's a true statement. There was a point in Jesus Christ's time in his life when he was lost, Sammy. That's what the Bible says. It said that they lost him. So they didn't know where he was at. Now, in the mind of God, in the mind of Christ, he wasn't lost. And I'm not speaking to the lost in sin. But I'm saying that there was a moment in time in Christ's life when they didn't know where he was at. And that, by definition, Jim is lost. Is that correct or not? By definition, he was lost. And they spent several days looking for him, and it says in 3 days. Now, what I find marchy irony about the story is, getting to where we're going, is this story could have happened in 1 day, and it could have happened in 2 days, but it happened in 3 days. And that 3 days kind of has a meaning. You ever thought about that, Sammy? 3 days. 3 days has a meaning. Because they didn't find him on the first or second day. It was on the third day. What day did Jesus rise on? The third day. Y'all know that? Jesus rose on the third day. I want y'all to think about something else. You can go read this in your Bible later. Do you know what happened on the third day in creation? Does anybody know what happened on the third day in creation? The third day. I'm not messing with you. On the third day in creation, God formed the earth together. Let that settle in for just a second. God on the third day formed the earth. Joe, what in the world does that have anything to do with anything? Because see, one day, Don, when he would go to rise, he'd shake that same earth. Things that we're puzzled about today is like, how did God raise him from the dead? He was just messing with something that he created. So Jesus was lost, okay? I experienced being lost in my life. Is there anybody else in the room that's ever been lost? I have. One, I have been lost in my direction. One, I have been lost in my way. Listen to this. And lastly, I'm going to be honest with you. There was a time in my life when I was lost in my sin. Anybody else besides me? I've been lost in my sin. I was lost. Another part of the story that's really cool is the Bible says, and it uses this word very specifically, it says, and after 3 days, they found him. That's pretty neat, isn't it? Now, Jesus was lost, and Jesus got found. Brother Doe, did you know something? Joey was lost. Now, there are a lot of you today in this church that would say, well, Brother Joey, I've been coming to church my whole life, and I've worked, and I've learned. I've gained understanding, and I've worked my way to God. That is an incorrect analysis of what's happened to you. That is not correct. You didn't do anything. There is not one intelligent person in this room that did anything. I don't care how morally correct you were. I don't care how studious you were about the Bible. I don't care what degrees you have. Not one of us ever in our life created the situation where we were found. I want you to understand something. God found us. You hear me? God found me. Listen to me. God found me and God saved me. Does everybody get that? God found me. Joey didn't save me. Hey, listen, I'm going to be honest with you. I have had the opportunity, listen to this. I have had the opportunity, Timmy, I have had the opportunity to lead a lot of lost people in the direction of Christ. But I didn't find them. God found them. You hear me what I'm saying? I'm going somewhere with this. I directed them. I gave them some directions, but I didn't find them. I didn't save them. And I'm going to tell you something. Thank God in heaven above, Brother Don, I ain't saved a person in my entire life, okay? Because if I did, Steve, it would have been absolutely worthless. I know that. So here Jesus was. Jesus was lost, and he was found. Those are cool new two places to relate to us. You know, Joey, God just can't relate to me sometimes. Did y'all know my Savior was lost? At one time, Joey, not in the relationship that we are. My Savior, the Bible tells me, was lost. And my Savior was found. How many of you were lost and found in Christ? I got 15 minutes now. Because now I'm getting started. All of that to get to here. I was lost and I was found. What did I find? What did I find, Steve? What did God find in me, I wonder, when God found me? God changed me. God sent me down a different path. God sent me down a different direction. All these things that God did to me. Did God do something special to anybody else in this room besides me? I'm going to be honest with you. God did something pretty special to me. This morning when I got to church, a lot of us stayed up and watched football last night. A lot of people wanted to remind me of something that I already knew. Sammy says they'll do you that way sometimes. But what I was amazed about is what they knew about it. I was. I'm amazed to listen to Christians tell me, and I ignorantly talk to them. I'm amazed to listen to Christians tell me about football and how much they know about it and how much they pay attention to it and how much they dwell on it and how much they focus on it and how big part of their life is and how they identify with it and how it means something to them and how it's life-changing. I'm talking about, do y'all know that if something happens in a couple weeks to a month, if Georgia were to do everything right, they could win 3 national championships. I'm talking about 3. It's unheard of. I bet you everybody in this room is probably going to get a check from the University of Georgia. It's going to be life-changing. It is. It's probably going to be life-changing. I'm talking about there will be times when people will stand up in churches and say, "Oh God, Georgia football changed me, preacher." Kind of the same way Alabama football changed some people, hadn't it, Sam? I want y'all to know something, Tommy. Georgia Tech football hadn't changed anybody. And we're proud of that. We're proud of that, Jim, we are. But it's this word, when Jesus was lost and Jesus was found, it's the word of business that bothers me. It's what Jesus was doing after he was lost and after he was found. Now, my dad was an electrician. I do electrical work. And one of my sons got into electrical work, tried to push the other one down that path. He wised out and went down a different path. That's okay. But I would say doing electrical work is my business. Is that a fair statement? Yeah. It is. It's a fair statement. But is it the right business to be in? I don't know the answer to that question. That one's puzzling me some days. Because, you see, when Jesus was found and his life was changed because he was found, now remember this, all, everybody in the room with me here today, we all, a lot of us in here, I'm not saying that all of us, I'm saying that a lot of us have claimed that we know Jesus. We claim that Jesus has come into our lives. We claim that Jesus has changed our lives. We claim that Jesus is sending us down a direction. We claim that Jesus has done these wonderful things for us. Yet we still are about somebody else's business. We're about somebody else's business. I'm going to be honest with you. We spend a lot of our time focused on other people's business. We do. We worry about other people's business. There are a lot of, I think the word in the church is called gossip. You know what gossip is? It's worrying about other people's business. I guess people gossip because they don't have enough business of their own to focus on. I guess people talk about other people and what they're doing because they don't have enough of their own to worry about. But some people, I'll give them credit, Toby, that they're so focused on what they're doing. They're focused on their business. And there's a lot of businesses to be focused on. There's the business of football. There's the business of work. I'll be honest with you. I think there's a business of family. I think there are a lot of people, Matthew, that are focused on their family. And I'm not telling you it's a bad thing, but there's a focus of businesses on the family. There's a focus of businesses. My business is my education, my kids, and my classroom. A lot of them they go to college, they're in school, they're trying to get educated, go down a path, and they've got the business of education. Y'all there with me? A lot of businesses to be focused on. But Jesus didn't say, "I was focused on business." You know, if I stop and think about it, Lynn, laugh about it a little bit. Max has what's called a business degree. Has anybody else got a business degree? You know what that is? Got business degrees, Daryl? We got some business degrees in the room. I got like you're in business. Your degree is getting into business. But none of these things are associated with the Father's business. None of them. So Jesus lost, Jesus was found. They come into the temple. He's sitting there and he's talking to people. He's asking questions. As the Bible even says, he's listening and he's asking questions. I wonder why Jesus was asking questions. I wonder what he was looking to know. I always thought about that. I'm weird. I know it's a weird sermon to some of y'all, but I'm weird about reading the Bible because I'm thinking here is an all-knowing God that he's being raised in church, and Jesus is asking them questions. You ever ask questions when you're in church? I want to answer that. Most of you in this room have never asked a question in church, Sunday school, in your life. And let me tell you why. Because you're not looking to know anything. That's a kaboom moment. You're not asking questions because you're not looking to know anything. My wife's a teacher. And I know Lynn can get up here and talk to you. But she will tell me when she teaches kids, she will notice that even the smartest of the kids, and Lynn, am I wrong about this? The smartest of the kids will ask questions. But those who don't know and don't care don't ask questions. Jim, you talk. Am I right or wrong? Those who don't know, who don't care, don't ask questions. Because they are not concerned with this business. Brother Dole. They're not concerned with this business. I want y'all to understand what Concord is doing, what we're doing. And I don't think most people in this room know. I really don't. I don't think you have absolutely any idea what this church is doing. Joey, I've been going here for 50 years. I've been going here for 40 years. And you still don't know what the purpose of this church is. You know why? Because you don't understand the business. Daryl, there's no understanding of the business. Well, Joey, what are we in business to do? Are we trying to raise money? Give me a second, Matthew. Y'all, don't get on me. They're going to lose me for a minute. I'm going to be right back here. Be gone. Matthew, stay back here in the back so nobody can get up and leave. Connie, is this accurate, pretty accurate? We have $544,000 in the bank. Is that accurate, pretty accurate? I believe her. I think she's right. We are not in the business to make money. That's not our business. Is that an amen or yes or no? Amen. Am I crazy? Are we in the business to save money? Am I crazy? Is that yes? Y'all can tell me yes or no. I don't care. Joey, you're an idiot. We're not giving money away. We're not giving it away. What's your point? Because we focus on this. It's up. It's posted. You know why it's posted? It's posted so you can see it. Because I'm going to tell you something. There are people in here that are worried about it. But I want you to know something. I want to submit to you. I want to submit to this church. This is not our business. That's not what we're in business to do. Listen to this. This is not the Father's business. This is not what He's in business to do. y'all know that God, he's got hilltops and mansions up there where God's at? They say that there's streets of gold and milk and honey flowing. Is God in the business to raise and make money? It's odd that churches are. Be honest. Funny that churches are. Jesus said, I am about the Father's business. Amen. Caleb, I know you're back there in the sound room. Can you open the glass for a second so I can see you? Caleb, I can see you back there. What's our business? We've been studying about it. That's our business. That's our business. That is what we are here to do. That is what we are called to do. That is what Jesus has instructed us to do. Do you know the Bible gives what is called the Great Commission? Do you know what the Great Commission, that most of y'all do? Do y'all know what the Great Commission is? Do you have any idea where it is in the Bible? How many of y'all have been here for over 40 years? Plus 40 years in church. I am willing to bet. I'm a gambler now, Steve. I'm a gambler. Listen to this. You have supported the church. You've given money to the church. You attend the church. You go to the church. You say prayers in the church, but you don't understand what the business of the church is. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. I could have some of y'all quote things about UGA football and stats that would blow my mind. Would blow my mind. And I'm not mad at you for knowing that. I mean, I think that's awesome. Joe, you know this and this story and this story. Man, They were last night, historical. They had things about happening in the Alabama-Auburn game 10 years ago and 15 years ago, and they'd be running, rerunning plays. And people say, man, I was there to tell that story. But you know, I can go to a Baptist church. I can go to most any Baptist church. I could take a poll this morning, Sammy, I could, and I could say, y'all, tell me what business we're in, and then show me in the Bible where to find it, and 90% of the Christians in that room would have no clue. And they've been sitting here their whole life. They don't even know what the Father's business is. Have no earthly idea what the Father's business is. They have no idea to go down the Father, what the Father's goals, what the Father's dreams, and what the Father's trying to accomplish. I'm going to help you today. The other day somebody told me, they said, Joey, help us. You gave me some help. I'm going to help you today. I'm going to help you today. It's found in Matthew 28. I'll make it even easier for you. It's the very end of Matthew 28. It's like the last verses in the Bible of that book. It's like the last verses. Jesus commissions us and tells us what the business is. He said, go into the world and teach. Hey, listen to that. Joey, he was talking to preachers. He was talking to deacons. He was talking to Sunday school teachers. No, he was not. He was talking to all of us who are about the Father's business. He was talking to every one of us who are born again believers. Every one of us that say we identify, we know that Jesus Christ is our Savior. We know that Jesus died on that cross. We know that He rose from that grave. We know that the Holy Spirit, Sammy, lives in us. He lives in us. Listen, y'all, the Holy Spirit isn't taking a nap in my life. The Holy Spirit isn't laying there hanging out. He lives in me. You hear me? He lives in me. And while he's living there, Timmy, he's got a purpose for me. Matthew, he's got a purpose for me. Now, I'm going to tell you something, y'all. I'm going to tell you what I do know. In doing the Father's business, it takes a lot of people to do it in different ways. Some of us, we end up preaching. Some of us, we end up teaching. Some of us end up in a prison ministry. Some of us, we end up in the workplace. Some of us, we end up in a schoolroom teaching and loving on kids. Some of us will end up in a home with our grandkids that we're trying to get to Jesus Christ. Listen to me. Joey, I hope that they get it somewhere else. I'm going to tell you something. Maybe they'll get, listen to this. I want y'all to know something about Jesus. I want y'all to know something. If you don't hear me on anything else, you hear me about what I'm about to tell you. They are not. There is nothing outside of those back doors that's going to teach you about Jesus Christ other than what goes on in this building today. You're not going to hear it on the radios. You're not going to hear it on the TVs. You're not going to hear it at the schoolhouses. You're not going to hear it at the workplaces. You're only going to get it here, and we got to take it out there. That's the business. That's the business we're in. That's the Father's business. It isn't here to come in here to hear a story on Sunday and hear a motivating speech from Joey. And Bill. Oh, Brother Joey, I feel good. I'm going to get through another week because of that message. Thank you. No, no, no. It isn't to say, hey, so we can raise money. Man, we're trying to help some kids. I thought, y'all, we're doing some good things. We are helping people. We are taking care of people. We're going down some good paths. But that's still not our purpose. Our purpose, our single purpose, is to go tell people about Jesus Christ and spread the gospel. That's the business. You know, somebody says, well, Joey, what's the model plan? What do I need to do? I'll be honest with you, the business plan ain't even complicated. It's not. It's pretty simple. I'm gonna grab something to you. I am going to ask a question to raise your hand. You're not going to have to answer me. Has anybody ever had God do something good for you? I'm going to raise both hands. Tommy, I'm going to raise both hands. And listen to this. And you can do that as a praise because it's okay to praise the Lord. It's Thanksgiving week. I'm going to praise Him. I'm going to raise both hands. In Mark chapter 5, Jesus told Legion one time the business plan. He did. He said, go home to your friends. Go home to your friends. You know what he said, Steve? He said, go home to your friends and tell them what good things that he's done. Toby, God bless your business. Yeah, he does. Sammy, God bless you at work. Jim, God blessing you in retirement. Yeah, he is. Timmy, God blessing you in your business. Daryl, God blessing you in your business. God blessing you in your home. God blessing you with your kids. Hey, listen, y'all, I'll be honest with y'all. I don't have some good things to tell Becky. I got a lot of good things to tell. I'm going to tell you something, man. My kids are healthy. I got a wife that loves me on some days. More days than she should, Archie, probably. I got a wife that loves me. I got a home. I got a roof over my head. I'm going to tell you, I ain't never went hungry. I ain't never went hungry. I can't identify with that, Sammy. I've passed homeless people. I got children that want to be around me, that don't hate me, that want to be part of my life. Man, I'm going to tell you something. I'm blessed. God's good to me. And you know what Jesus said? Go tell people how God has been good. You know, some of us, you get out in workplace and we'll just talk about how bad our life is. Man, you, Joey, don't know. Listen, God don't care. Listen, don't go tell people. Everybody's got stuff going on. Go tell them about the good things. Listen, if I had to hear some of your witness stories, it's no wonder that nobody around you's ever come to Jesus. The way some of you frown, the way some of you act, the way some of you are sorry. Listen to me. I got a great God who is an awesome God who chose to be part of my life, who lives in my life, who blesses my life, and hallelujah. Amen. He's good to me. Now, he's good to me. Poppy, he's good to me. But he didn't just tell Legion to go tell him how good he was. Did he, Sammy? He didn't just say go tell him how good he was. in the business plan because he said, tell them something else. Well, Joey, what else did he do? He's been good to me, but what else did he do? Turns out, Timmy, Jesus did something else. He had mercy on me. That's what he told the agent, isn't it? He said, go home and tell thy friends what good things that he's done and how he has had mercy on you. Brother Dole, has God shown you mercy? Marchie, has God shown you mercy? Tommy, has God shown you mercy? Tyler, has God shown you mercy? Do you think it's a mercy that you deserve? Do you think it's something that you were owed? Do you think it's something that you should have been given? That's why it's called mercy. And yet we all have that. God didn't owe us salvation. We weren't deserving of it. We didn't earn it. We didn't work for it. He showed me mercy, Daddy Pope. He showed me mercy. And you know what, Nicole? Without that mercy, I will never, ever see him. Y'all know that, Steve? Without that mercy. Take a deep breath. We're almost home. God's been good to me, Jackie, and God's shown me mercy. Jesus said, go tell them that's the Father's business. And maybe they'll see. I'm going to tell y'all something, folks. We're about a lot of things. We are about a lot of things. And we've got a lot of businesses. And we got a lot of things that I'm not trying to show you what's important, what's not important, what should be or what shouldn't be. But I'm going to tell you the number one thing this business is about. It's his business. Listen to me. I pray. You know what my prayer is? You know my prayer is for Brother Joey, Brother Sammy? My prayer for this church is that every person, let me say that again. I'm going to say it right. Every born-again Christian. Every born-again Christian. Because if you're not born again, you don't get this. If you're yawning about to go to sleep, like, I'm ready to get out of here. I get it. You don't get it. If you're sitting there saying, who is he to talk about them Bulldogs? Who is he to talk about Alabama like that? I had a guy tell me the other day. It was an Alabama fan. He said, Joey, it's going to get funny when you get to heaven and you see that crimson flag flying up there. I said, dude, it's going to be funny when you get there and you see it ain't. And I love you. But I'm going to tell you something. We need to redefine the business and figure out what we're about. Folks, we're not about the money. We're not about the gifts. We're not about the games. We're not about playing. We will be about the Father's business. And as Caleb said right back there, and I ask it every Sunday school, what are we talking about? Getting out there and getting people to Jesus Christ. He was lost. He was found. But you know what? When Jesus was found, you know what he did? He was about the Father's business. If you've been lost, and praise God you've been found, then you should be about the Father's business too. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, so grateful, so thankful for all the many wonderful things that you've done for us. God, you are good to us. God, some of us need to come up with a new business plan. When I look and I see what's going on outside these walls tonight, dear Jesus, Lord, or today, When I was studying, y'all, called Brother Sammy the other day. I'm going to say this while I'm praying. We are closer than we'll ever know to Christ coming back. And I don't care if it's 5 years from now or 10 years from now or 50 years from now. Jesus is coming back. And when you look across time and realize we're sitting in those days, everything about His Word shows us that, we better be about the Father's business right now. If you got loved ones in your families, you got people that you know you don't know, you got friends, you got people you work with, I'm going to tell you something. Focus. Get focused on the Father's business. Lord, we're so thankful for all the things that you're doing for us in this church. God, as we go through this season, I pray that you bless us as we lift you up and we worship your holy name. Lord, if there's one here today that's never accepted you as their Savior, God, they can't go to a time and a place in their life where they asked Jesus Christ to come in. They sought out the forgiveness. Lord, I pray this morning, dear Jesus, Lord, the Holy Spirit would prick their heart. Come grab Brother Sammy, grab Sister Marchie, grab me, dear Jesus, Lord, and say, man, Joey, I got to know how to get there. I want to make the Father my business. I want to take this time and thank you for watching and worshiping with us today. My name is Joey Dibman. I'm with Concord Missionary Baptist Church. If you are not a follower of Jesus Christ and have never asked Him to come into your heart, I'd like to take a few moments to help you do just that. You know, the Bible tells us in Romans 10:9 that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. You know, this is open to every one of us that requests, because Romans 10:13 goes on to say even deeper, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So today, if you would like to pray with me, let's bow our heads in prayer to our Lord and Savior and ask Him if you're seeking Him to come into your heart today. Lord, I just want to take the opportunity that if there's someone out there today, and dear God, Lord, they're seeking you. Dear God, Lord, and maybe they're at a place in their life where they can't see. But today, through the Holy Spirit, which has pricked their heart, through your word, not the words that I preach, but through the holy word of an awesome Father, God, I pray today, dear God, Lord, that they would be enlightened. And God, I'd ask them today to pray with me and say, Lord, I want to be a believer. Dear God, Lord, I want to believe in the fact that I know that you walked on this earth. Lord, I want to know that you died for my sins. God, I want to believe in the fact that on the third day you resurrected from a tomb and you sit on the right hand of God. And today, Lord, I want to ask you to come into my heart. And Lord, if there's one out there praying with us today, dear God, Lord, that's seeking you, Lord, I pray that they would say this prayer with me today, dear God, Lord, and invite Jesus Christ into their heart to forgive their sins. Lord, we thank you for your blessings upon us. God, we thank you for what you're doing for us. I just pray that you'd be with us through this moment in time. And dear God, Lord, and show us the things that you'd have us to see. In Christ's name we pray, Lord. Amen. You know, if you've done that today, if you've taken the opportunity to ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart, you know, he died on a cross close to 2,000 years ago and he walked on the earth. The Bible teaches us that everyone that calls upon the name of the Lord and believes in their heart that he has risen from the grave shall be saved. So if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior today, now I want to invite you to, you know what, into your new relationship with your Father. And I want to maybe help you, maybe through watching the videos as you learn and you grow, but maybe try to find a church that's close to you. A church home where you can go with other believers and walk with them and learn to grow with them. I invite you today also that maybe if today you've asked Christ to come into your heart, that you know what, maybe you would let us know. And drop us a postcard to say, you know, hey, I listen to these videos on YouTube. I appreciate what you've done. But I would like for y'all to know that on this date, on so-and-so, that I asked Jesus Christ to come into my heart. We'd invite you, and if you look at the address that's on the screen today and maybe send a postcard. And then, you know what, if you don't want to write it down, maybe through email. There will be an email address that you can address to our church at Concord Missionary Baptist Church. And you could just email us and let us know what's going on in your life. But even better than that out there today, maybe you are a Christian today, and maybe you're not here in Temple, Georgia with us, but you're in your walk with Jesus today, and you're having some valleys that you're having to go through. And maybe you need to seek some prayer requests and some other shoulders to lean on. I invite you to also to email us or drop us a card. We meet on Wednesday nights to pray. We take these things before the Father. We take these things very seriously, and we come together as a group as we pray to our Father. So I'd invite you to send those prayer requests to us, and I promise you that we'll take them and put them on the altar and bring them before the Lord. Once again, I want to thank so much for you taking your time to come spend with us and worship with us, you know, through song, through word, but more than anything else, through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May God bless you and your family.